very difficult to treat and so on. And ticks that cause harm, as you know, unfortunately, are not that rare. But ticks cause injury to the person. There's a trend for self-poking, hitting, things like that, often around the eyes, mouth. They are vulnerable places. We can hurt a lot. Then there's all the problem of the strain, so repetitive movements which cause joint damage, pulled muscles, and so on. This is, to me, a very under-researched, understood area. The ticks do cause physical harm, physical damage. We are actually doing a study right now, as I speak, using the McGinn, which is a pain scale used for arthritis, a lot of other conditions, and it sort of lists of possible kinds of pain that people can get, and we are trying to document the extent of and the nature of the pain caused by the ticks. These are other cases, multiple self-injurious behaviors. So, part of the pain of the injuries caused by the ticks themselves, other injuries caused by the impulsivity, especially children who have ADHD, impulse control disorder, sometimes lash out, hit themselves. So, acting out, anger outbursts, which result in self-hitting, headbanging, things like that. If you have any questions, feel free to stop. You want me to stop?
I do. You said that you, it's like kind of a less studied area.
Yeah.
So are they still considering treatment of those things? Because it seems like it's sort of an all-for-one treatment, even though we know each case of Tourette is pretty different.
Yeah.
Are you seeing changes in treatment for those types of things at all?
Yeah, that's a good point. So we have like the guidelines for the treatment of Tourette syndrome. There are the European guidelines, the Canadian guidelines. I can't find any specific guidance on treating the pain which results from the tics. So I think it's left to the GPs really. And they go on, you know, these days with tramadol and opiate-like, very easily, which have side effects, they can cause depression. There was an article in the BMJ not long ago that these opiate-based analgesics can cause depression if abused in the long term and so on. So it's a very good point. Sometimes the nature of the pain is more neuropathic rather than muscular joint. It depends, really. So you can avoid causing harm by giving the wrong painkiller. Other bizarre presentation, this is a case series that we wrote with Jim Lechman from Yale. And these were patients who had socially inappropriate behaviors. They were not swearing. It was laughing, actually. They felt the urge to laugh when it was inappropriate, so at the funeral, job interview, and these things, they would not go out in the fear of offending people, really, for that. Again, just to document things that the general public, but also the general medical audience, doesn't often get. They don't think that there's a condition that can cause this. Socially inappropriate symptoms been also termed NOSI, non-obscene socially inappropriate behaviors. And I was giving an example early on at lunch. It's not necessarily swearing. It's like the brain that generates the tics as a radar and detects social cues. As soon as it detects that something would be inappropriate in that context, then it generates the urge to do exactly that. Swearing is often inappropriate. That's why it's so often, that is, compared to the other socially inappropriate behavior, because it's inappropriate in most contexts. But I remember I was giving a talk a bit like this in Birmingham a few years ago, and there were people with Tourette, of course, in the audience. And the moment I started speaking, and they heard my Italian thick accent, someone started shouting, pizza, Mario, mafia, and then it was a concert throughout the talk, which I enjoyed.
I will...
Reconcile me with my origin.
I do know that there is one boy who lives close by who has Tourette, and one of his inappropriate things is a response to having certain other children in the classroom. And they said, well, as soon as we take him out of the classroom, you know, he doesn't do that anymore. And so trying to explain to people it's that urge that's the, and they do they still not understand what it is at all that causes that particular?
Now, what they told you is an hypothesis, that the brain subconsciously monitors the environment as soon as it detects something that would be socially inappropriate, then it generates the urge to do that. But how this happens in real terms, which part of the brain does what, something we still don't know. So, not necessarily swearing, socially inappropriate sort of behaviors. Swearing, what about the swearing? Well, described by Gilles de la Tourette, but we now know that it's only 30% of people who are seen in specialist clinics who also have a swearing tic. And as you know, it's swearing out of context, not when my football team loses, but... it can be swearing, but it can be rude gestures. So coprolalia, if it's swearing, or copropraxia, if it's bad signs, and so on. In the general population, like in schools, it's even rarer, the swearing. It's 10% of the children with tics. Yes?
You said that 30% that swear, that's of Tourette's, or that's of...
Tourette seen in clinic. Okay. So these are the more severe ones. Because they have reached the clinic. In the school, it's 10% of the ones with Tourette. 1 in 10 in school.
Okay.
So, in general, this is a broad topic. And coming back to what you were saying, what do we know about these social aspects? We know that the social context matters a lot. Any tic, also the simple tics, get worse when we are under social pressure and speaking in front of people, all sorts of, brings up all sorts of movements and noises and everything. We paid attention to this and tried to understand, and this has been quite revealing. So the same part of the brain, those basal ganglia that were mentioned before about generating the tics and so on, they are also involved in this social cognition. So reading other people's minds, what he will be thinking if I swear now? What will he say if I... How will he take what I say? Putting yourself in other people's shoes, okay? So this is theory of mind. And we now know that there's good evidence, part of this research has been done in Birmingham, that people who have Tourette have a special theory of mind. Special way of putting themselves in the shoes of other people. Often they overthink. So they say something. I saw a child yesterday, no longer a child, he's now in his early 20s. And he was telling me yesterday, Daniel, that he finds himself up in the night in his bed thinking about things he said early on in the day and how the person he was speaking with could have received, could have taken what he just said. I'm feeling guilty sometimes. Maybe I should have used another word. Maybe he misunderstood. Maybe he's now against me because of what I said. Thinking a lot about other people. And we tend to see this in people who have tics. A brain that is overactive generates the extra movement, the urges, it also generates extra thoughts in a way. We were also talking with someone before. In a way, it's a talent. It's not always a loss. It's not something that is a deficit. It works less. But sometimes it's overactive. We don't know what causes it. We don't know what happens in the brain exactly. But by looking at families, we know that it tends to run in families. So the genetic side of Tourette has been known for a long time. This is, again, 19th century, Armand Trousseau, another French doctor, and he captured, together with Gilles de la Tourette, this hereditary familial component. He noticed that the relatives were more likely to have tics than the general population. We now know that there's a genetic heterogeneity. What does it mean? It means that it's not a case of one gene causes all the cases of Tourette. Unfortunately, it's not that easy. We think that there are multiple genes, but very many genes, scattered throughout the genome, virtually in every chromosome, that if mutated or if present in a variant, make you vulnerable to develop tics. Maybe you don't develop tics, but your genetic background had some variants in chromosome 3, 11, and 19 that made you vulnerable to develop tics at some point in life. Very heterogeneous. And that basically means that, as it happens with most neuropsychiatric conditions, including Parkinson, the genes load the gun, but then there's something that pulls the trigger. So there's a lot of people with the gun loaded, with some genes that would make them vulnerable to develop tics, but the trigger is never pulled, and they never develop tics. So what pulls the trigger? We think that there's something in the environment. So the two things together, having the right or wrong genes plus something that happens in the environment, causes the problem. And for some time we thought that we'd found the environmental trigger pulling factor, in not in the animals, but in the pandas, as in pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with this bug, the strep, which is a throat bacterium, really. And this idea that having these infections, tonsillitis, recurrent throat infections, chest infections, more than average, would result in an immune response directed at the bug, trying to kill the bug, but then cross-reacting with the brain. So attacking not just the bug, but also the brain, and in particular this basal ganglia, this part of the brain. So this hypothesis was put forward 15 years ago by Susan Swedo and tested in several labs in the world, initially with some good results, like they found an association there. The children with the tics had higher levels of autoantibodies, so antibodies attacking the own brain, compared to children without any tic. So, small studies in some labs in the world initially found this, but then the largest study published in Neurology, an important journal, again North American, by Harvey Singer's lab, failed to replicate these findings, and this was the best study, like the most authoritative lab, largest number of patients. So we are not so sure about it. We did a study in London with some colleagues with voxel-based morphometry and DTI, MRI, this is all jargon, but basically we were looking at the brain with a brain scan with high resolution. And looking at the basal ganglia of patients with Tourette with the antibodies versus patients with Tourette without the antibodies. So let's see if the antibodies made any change to their basal ganglia. And we didn't find any. There's no difference there. There's no scar, there's no enlargement, shrinking, nothing. So again, you would expect to find something there. We didn't. So this hypothesis that the environmental culprit is the bug has lost some favor. And the evidence against this is building up. I would say this is from 2013, but now the evidence against the role of the streptococcus is as much as the evidence in favor. So we think that it might still be true that in a small proportion of children with tics, their tics are caused by the genes plus the strep infections. But it's a small proportion, it's not all. Moreover, there's not much practical value in this, because when they try to remove the antibodies from the blood of the children who had the tics after the tonsillitis and so on, they didn't see any improvement. There was no change. And there are ways to remove the antibodies with immunoglobulins, with plasmapheresis, and so on. They tried, but no results. The jury is still out. We are trying to better characterize that sub of patients who have this streptococcus sort of link. And this is the largest study ever done in Europe to date. It was funded by the FP7, large funding program of the EU, a few years ago, and it's still ongoing. And after Brexit, I don't know what's going to happen with the recruiting centers in England, but they were part, really, of the largest study to date, exactly looking at this. This is the European group, some friends, of course, we meet every year. This is the largest brain imaging study ever conducted in patients with Tourette. 154 patients with tics were scanned and compared with people without tics. And they focused on these basal ganglia and to see whether there are any differences. They couldn't find much, really. So we can't use neuroimaging, brain scanning, to diagnose Tourette. The only thing that they found, and it is a small difference, really, in the caudate nucleus, part of this basal ganglia, slightly smaller in people with tics. But this difference emerged only when you compare the very large number of brains. If you compare, if you take one patient from this group and one control from this group, you find that this difference disappears. So only when you have large numbers. So again, no clinical, unfortunately, use for brain imaging, only to rule out other things. Is it a stroke? Is it a... I won't bore you with this. This is other similar stuff. This is also an interesting study. It was done back when I was in Italy, 15 years ago or so. I was a trainee, and I bumped into a couple of twins. And one had come to the clinic because he had severe tics. Then I discovered that he had an identical twin, so same genes. But the twin never had a tic in his own life. So I was quite puzzled by that. It was not the first time that it was reported in the world that two identical twins are discordant for Tourette. We know that the concordance is 90% in identical twins. But we managed to get them scanned, and we looked at the density of white matter in the brain, in a region, which is the corpus callosum, which has an inhibitory function over the basal ganglia. So, one twin had the tics throughout his life, the other one never had tics. The one who had the tics had a much thicker bundle of white matter in this part of the brain that inhibits basal ganglia. What does it mean? But we don't know, but surely they started with the same brain, they had the same genes. That is something that happened later on in life. So there is this concept that the brain of people with tics changes throughout life. Is it because of having the urges? Is it because of constantly suppressing the tics or trying to? Is it because of the tic expression? We don't know. But we certainly know that there's plasticity there, changes with time. And this is an important thing because rarely we take it into account. We do a study, we think that the brain is dead. No, is it children? How many years were they exposed to the tics, adults, and so on?
Was there any other studies done after that?
Yeah, there's one by Kerstin Plessen. She used to work in Norway, now she's in Denmark, in Copenhagen. And she worked with Bradley Peterson, did the largest imaging study. And their study was in children, and they found also this change in the corpus callosum. I go fast on this. Behavior. So, I said, yeah?
What age were the twins?
They were... I don't want to tell you something wrong, because a few years ago, I need to look at the paper. But it was an adult service. They were young adults. They were like 20, something like that. But if you find the paper, you find that I'm wrong, feel free to correct. The behavior, so this was again a big paradigm shift, so a change in the view we see Tourette. Year 2000, the turn of the millennium, a couple of very important papers are published on Tourette syndrome. One is by Joe Jankovic, the Texas Houston-based movement disorder expert. The other one is Jim Lechman, child specialist from Yale. And both present Tourette syndrome to the general medical audience at the turn of the millennium. This is where we are with Tourette now, for you all to know. They both portray Tourette syndrome at the overlap between tics, ADHD, OCD, and impulsivity. So it's not just a movement thing, even the movement disorder expert agrees, it's something that involves behavior. Hence, the presence of Tourette in both the movement disorder and the psychiatric classification systems. So we now think that there's a continuum, a spectrum there, from people who have the simple tics, transient tics or just motor tics without the vocal tics and so on, to the patients who have the full-blown thing, which is what Gilles de la Tourette described in the 19th century, with the swearing, with the echoing. And finally, to what we tend to see in clinic, people who have everything I said, plus behavioral symptoms. ADHD children, OCD, also adults. Most common comorbidity in adults is OCD. I told myself not to use the word comorbidity, I resist half an hour and came asleep. So the extra of OCD. So you find in a review article, this is one that we were asked to write for the BMJ 3 years ago, and you find all these overlapping circles that describe Tourette. It's not one thing, but it's the overlap between the tics and a number of other things. Impulsivity, also depression, and so on. We know that the vast majority of people who receive a diagnosis of Tourette don't have just the tics. This is the largest clinical study ever conducted on Tourette syndrome. 3,500 people with Tourette worldwide, recruited from specialist clinics in 22 countries. It was done a few years ago, led by a Canadian colleague, Roger Freeman. And when putting together all this data, what they found was that only 12% of patients with Tourette had just Tourette. 90% had at least one associated problem. As I say, ADHD, children, about 60%. OCD, 30 to 60%, but also adults, staying throughout life. Sometimes they're getting even more severe than adults. Same finding was replicated a few years later in Scandinavia. Now, can you think of any bias in the study led by the Canadian that I just mentioned? Large number, 22 countries, but as I said, it was run in specialist clinics. If you remember, this is where the more severe complex cases are seen. So some people said, of course, 90% had associated behavioral problems. You looked for them in specialist clinics. So the Scandinavians, who are traditionally very well organized, managed to replicate the study in the community. They went into the schools and screened for tics children there, and they found the same thing, that in the children newly diagnosed with Tourette in the community, so not the more severe cases, 90%, 92% actually, had at least one associated behavioral problem. It's part of it. We ran a study with Mary Robertson in London a few years ago, and we reviewed 650 plus patients of her. Some were Hugo Critchley's patients, some were my patients, because with time we took over. And we found exactly the same figure. If you you look, there's only 10% of all these patients who had just Tourette. So really, you keep replicating this finding, 9 out of 10 have more. What do they have more? OCD, as I said, starts in childhood, often, sometimes in adolescence, and then it persists through life. What kind of OCD? Someone said it before already. Is that just right? Physical feeling-driven OCD. Complex rituals, repetitive behaviors, but driven by the physical urge to get things right. People feel physically uncomfortable until they have accomplished the ritual. There's not so much in terms of, I want to wash repeatedly my hands because I feel I can get contaminated. That's too much thinking. It's very physical. You have to do it because it feels uncomfortable. Not so much in terms of magical thinking. Something bad will happen to my sister, my boyfriend, if I don't accomplish the ritual. It's not to write that. It's more physical. So, these differences have been replicated in several studies in Holland, in France, and they are relevant. Because if the OCD symptom is driven by the physical urge, it can sometimes respond to the same treatment that you use for the tics. You kill two birds with one stone with that. You give an anti-dopaminergic treatment sometimes, and it can also help with this particular type of OCD. You don't need to use many more things. I go faster, otherwise. Impulsivity, again, it's there, it's a problem, temper tantrums, acting out. It follows that lack of inhibition, if you want. But it's very hard to inhibit the extra urges, the extra movements generated by the brain, so it's hard to inhibit the reactions. Again, we see them very often, especially in children who have ADHD. As an associated problem. All of this tells you really that Tourette syndrome is now considered an umbrella term. It's not one condition, but it's an umbrella under which there are several different, slightly different, and sometimes quite different clinical presentations. One of the most fruitful lines of research to date is to identify the different types of Tourette. The Tourette that is a bit of a warrior with the OCD, the Tourette who is acting out, impulsive with the ADHD, that 10% of Tourette only without the behavioral problem. These are all types of Tourette. So we think, again, that that's why there are different genes involved, because it's different conditions. They share the tics, yes, but they are different. Until we identify the different types, we associate each type with the genes, its own genes, and we understand what happens in the brain for each type, we won't be able to move forward with treating it. So, last bit, treatment. There is a lot of focus these days on quality of life. And I agree with that. I like very much what the person before me said.
Her name is Jasmine.
Jasmine, yes. Say, a person, a child, has 50 tics. And sometimes we see that, and a lot of tics. But how many of these tics cause impairment, trouble, pain? Maybe it's 2 or 3 of these 50. Another child might have only 5 tics, but they are all bad. And the child is more severe. So it really changes a lot case by case. And you can't just tick box and rate the number. And you need to ask and see in your environment what happens when you're at school. But I see routinely patients who are very disabled, in my view, very severe tics with self-harm and all this. But they live, luckily, in a good environment where there's a lot of understanding. There's people around them, family to start with, who see through the tics, who understand the child, understand the person, and value the person for the talents, and even more so for the fact that they have been able to overcome the tics. So they have achieved more than the average. That person has a better quality of life. Then a person who maybe has a couple of mild tics, but is very, doesn't know what it is, anxious, concerned, am I crazy, what's happened to me, people around don't understand. So the social environment, all this is bad, it's negative, it's giving negative messages there. They feel singled out, bullied, they feel self-conscious, they become withdrawn. Then in that case, even if they are mild in terms of tic severity, quality of life can be poor.